built, but it was also a church, which really is the people, the Ecclesiastes, the called out ones. And we've watched God do miraculous things. We've watched healings of cancer, lumps on the neck just disintegrate there and then when you're praying for them. I think my dad calculated that there's been about 300 and up to about 350 now people that received the gift of the Holy Ghost and baptized in Jesus' name. Like the scriptures though, Pastor Robert said, oh, stay around. Some of that word falls on that thorny soil, and as soon as something comes up against them, people are gone.
But Lord.
One of the miraculous things that I personally think is because I was one of them. I grew up from a young age in church. From the age of two, it's actually a prayer that my dad prayed over me. When I was 2 years old, he said, God, if you're real, didn't know God, didn't know anything about him, went to Church of England about three times in his life. And he said, God, if you're real, I don't want to have a relationship with my son like my father did with me. And my grandfather was a street fighter. He grew up in the war. He was one of the toughest men you'll probably ever meet. Mean man to his own. It was that prayer that within 6 weeks, he found himself in an apostolic church.
Amen.
And his testimony is miraculous, but it was through that God used him in crazy ways. And I grew up under this ministry of hearing stories of demons appearing in restaurants through people and speaking out through people. And it's awesome because it sets a foundation. It shows you something real. Yes. And when I was about 18, I decided, you know what, I'm going to try and do something myself instead of this church malarkey. And it was 18 to about 5 or 6 years, and I tried to do whatever I wanted to do, how I wanted to do it. I was at university, and I was never satisfied. There was something missing. There was something that I hungered for, something that I wanted, something that just I didn't have peace about. And it was about 6 years ago now that I decided, you know what, I'm going to stop fighting God. I'm going to stop going. I need to find out what it is for real. I don't want to just be living off of my dad's. He was my pastor, off his relationship, which it's easy to do. You know, pastors are there. They have the responsibility, if you want to say, of being the one, if you almost who prays the most, who reads his Bible the most. And it's almost easy to follow someone like that and say, oh, actually, you know, I've gone to church and pastor preached a good word, or this guest speaker preached a good word, and I'm all right for another week. But I decided to actually find out who God was for real. Amen. In the same way, I said to God, I want to find out who you are. If I know you're real, but I don't know you. I know of you. I can quote a lot of scriptures. I can probably give most people a good run for their money in the scriptures. But I really don't know you, God. I never really let you into my own life, and I've really never delved into yours. Because God created us in his image. So if we have our own lives, God has his. He has his own characteristics, his own attributes. He isn't just this distant orb of light that we can't comprehend. We can't comprehend him, but he's made himself accessible, being manifested in the flesh.
Amen.
I'm going to speak about truth today. Hopefully speak truth and speak about truth. And I just want to, if you turn in your Bibles, if you have your Bibles with you, I'm not going to go, if you stand for the reading of the Word, and I'm just going to read a short scripture. So if you've got your Bibles, if you turn to John 3:33.
Thank you, Jesus.
I'm not reading from the King James, so don't think you're going crazy if the words come out. I know. Don't quite match the ones on your page. I'm reading from the English Standard Version because I find it slightly easier to comprehend. I read both, but the ESV to me helps me a little bit more. I'm not as smart as I'd like to be, I guess. I'm only a dumb man. So John 3:33. He that hath received his testimony hath set to his seal that God is true.
Amen.
In Jesus' name. Father, I pray that your words would be in my mouth today. Your words of truth, God, would be in my mouth today, God. That the hearts of the people sitting in front of me, Lord, would be cultivated by your spirit, God. And whatever needs to be spoken would be spoken, God. And whatever needs to be received would be received, God. That the encouragement would be given, Jesus, through your word and through your spirit, God. I thank you, God, for what you've done for me, God. I thank you for saving me, God, from a life of sin, Jesus. A life of unsatisfaction, Jesus. Thank you for who you are, God, standing there outside of time, God, still with your arms open, God, for eternity, asking me to just be with you, God, to know you, to walk in a relationship with you, Jesus. In the name of Jesus.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you very much for standing for the reading of God.
Amen.
I already started exploring your city this morning. Across from my hotel is a little authentic coffee shop, one of those hipster type coffee shops, not Starbucks or Costa or Cafe Nero, whatever. One of those where they say they're trendy and it's direct from the farm to your cup type of place. It's good coffee. I love coffee. But I got a great chance to sit there and actually read my Bible this morning. There's some real nice people in there, but I got a chance to read my Bible. And I was reading in the book of John, and that's where I'm going to be preaching from today. But really, I never noticed the trend in the book of John as I did today. And the trend in the book of John is truth. You've got young John, who was the youngest of all the disciples, or the apostles. He was in the inner circle of Jesus Christ. He was the youngest there. John got to sit back and he got to watch. He got his character and his attributes and everything about him were shaped by the ministry of Jesus Christ. So he had a first-hand experience. And you look at his gospel. He writes it different to the rest of them.
Yeah.
He isn't trying to prove a lineage. He isn't trying to prove that Christ necessarily fulfilled all the scriptures. He does in bits. But what he tries to show is that this was truth on earth. That this was the truth. This is the Christ on earth. It gets brought up constantly. A trend that who is this man? This Galilean. And I saw it on your song list. We love this man from Galilee, I think was the song. I mean, I don't know the song, but it's on there. And it's funny. He was just some country redneck, according to our standards. You know, do you guys have the feud here in South Wales, like we do in North England, where obviously the Southerners aren't as good as the Northerners, and you guys might be here like South Wales, you know, we're the smart ones in the Northern Wales, they're the dumb ones. Nothing mean, it's just a bit of banter. My Kenyan friend said that it's the Ugandans who are the Irish to the English. But whatever, it's a bit of fun. We don't really mean it. But to them, look how close they were to Samaria. Samaritans were unclean, they were dirty. And then you've got these Galileans.
Yeah.
And Jesus Christ comes out of Galilee.
Yes.
He wasn't the shiny knight that they thought would free them from the Roman Empire. Roman Empire. But as you'll see, and I'll read the scripture about the truth setting you free. There was a liberation of the people, not necessarily physically at the time, but a spiritual liberation that then bled into the physical after his death, because the truth was on the earth.
Amen.
The truth, when we look at the word in the Greek, and I'm going to just quickly give us a little lesson so we know where we're at here. The word truth comes from a root word. It's the G227, I think it is, in Strong's. And it comes from a word that has, it comes from the root word of two words, technically. One is the letter alpha, and then the other word is hidden, or concealment. And the alpha, as a prefix, that goes before any word, when they're joined together, that alpha makes a negative connotation, or the opposite of what that word's supposed to mean. So if I said, I don't know, my wife is... I'll say alpha ugly, that would mean she's very pretty. Yeah, do you understand that? It flips the word. So when you bring alpha with concealment, you have that it's not hidden anymore. So the word truth isn't necessarily what we look at in the Old Testament, which is more just a firmness, just an authority. It was solid, there was a consistency. But in the New Testament, truth was actually that which was no longer hidden.
Amen.
And when we talk about, yeah, we've got the truth, then really, if we have the truth, we have to kind of think, well, what is this that we have? This was something that the prophets, the law, even the writers of King David and Psalms and Songs of Solomon, they wrote about this truth, and they did not have a full understanding. All they knew is that God, who had been their father and who had been their healer, who had been their strong tower, who had been everything to them, their provider, he had given them manna. He was a consistent in their life.
Right.
And it even says in the New Testament, this is that which the prophets spoke about. Amen. This is that
Amen.
Which they
yes.
Don't you understand that
Amen.
What they would have given to be in your position?
Right.
This is that. It's no longer hidden. And when we look at, going back to Alpha, when we look in the book of Revelation, that again, John wrote, because John had this understanding, and Christ talks to him and says, I am the Alpha and the Omega. I'm the beginning. I'm nothing to everything.
Amen.
I know it's Alpha is the beginning letter of the alphabet and Omega is the end. But when you look at what Alpha and Omega really mean, it's the beginning and everything.
Yes, amen.
God is everything. The very breath that we breathe is atoms. And those atoms that are broken down into protons in a nucleus. And then that nucleus is actually broken down into even smaller subatomic particles called quarks. Mm-hmm. I don't know if any of you knew that. God is still in between all of that matter. Mm-hmm. And he still makes up all of that, that we breathe, that we walk, things that we take for granted. None of us are walking around like this because of gravity being too much on this planet.
Amen.
He tweaked the dial on gravity just enough so we could stand up, just enough so we didn't float away.
That's right.
He sat there meticulously and planned our lives. Mm-hmm. Do you understand that?
Amen.
That our hands, there's a reason we have a thumb. Do you think he made the monkeys one? Actually, you know what? I'm gonna give them a thumb. You know, so maybe Charles Darwin, looking at his monkeys and stuff, he was like, well, actually, we're different, right? Because God's not, he's not going to make us without a thumb because we needed it. Yeah. How else could I build? How else could I hold a hammer? Mm-hmm. How else could I hold the microphone?
Right. That's right.
I know it wasn't made for that, but let's just think like that for a minute. But when we look at, when we look in Hebrews, it says that God is the author and the finisher of our salvation.
Amen.
God, in the beginning, created the heavens and the earth. In the beginning was the Word. In the beginning, the word there meaning blueprint. God had a design in the beginning for us now. It's funny how it all works out, Pastor Roberts. It doesn't matter where we are, and Sister Glennis, we're talking about things going on. We do go through seasons. My season right now might be a much happier, joyous season. We all have the Spirit of God, but it's not to say that we're going to not have things in our life that come up against us. Things that just, we can't, we're about here. We feel like we're in a hole. We see the side of the hole. We can't see what's in front of us. We see something there, and we're close to the problem. Therefore, the problem looks bigger than it is. And I spoke this in our church years ago, but when we step back and look at the problem through God's eyes, the problem becomes a very small speck on the radar.
That's right.
That's it. And when we look at the bigger picture, because our lives weren't meant to be here just to go and go to school, go to work, you know, enjoy some good food, some good coffee, whatever. When we look at what we were created for, we have air that fills our lungs. We have hands that clap, feet that move. We have a brain that can memorize things, a brain that can remember things to give God glory.
Amen.
That's the sole purpose of being here. And when Christ came onto this earth, and in Timothy it says that without great controversy, there's no great debate in this. The mystery of God is that which was hidden has been revealed.
Amen.
That Christ was manifested in the flesh.
Amen.
God was manifested in the flesh. He was seen on by angels. Angels saw him.
Yes.
The ones who had stood there. Do you know this? And my wife's father preaches. Lucifer doesn't have, the fallen angels don't have a plan of salvation.
No.
Do you know why he hates you? He will never, ever, ever be able to get back into heaven. His mistake is his eternity.
Mm-hmm.
Our mistakes are no longer our eternity because the truth was revealed.
Yeah.
That God manifest in the flesh, seen on angels, preached unto the Gentiles.
Mm-hmm.
The scum of Israel, no, we don't talk to them, we don't touch them. If I was an Israelite and I touched Brother Roberts, who clearly is a Welshman, so he would be a Gentile, I would be unclean. I couldn't go give thanks to God that night. I have to wait until the sacrifice had been done. But no longer.
Amen.
He's my brother, you're my sister, you're my brother. It doesn't matter what you look like. Hey, it doesn't even matter what you smell like. Amen. We always talk about looks, but we forget about there's four other senses. You might smell a bit funny, you know, but we're all still brothers and sisters if we have His Spirit.
Yes.
And those that don't still have that chance because God hasn't blown the final trumpet. Christ isn't sitting on a white throne of judgment saying yes, no, maybe so. Or he doesn't say maybe so, but it would be nice if you think, but no, you want God to divide. You want Him to be yes or no. You don't want no maybes.
Praise God.
But truth has to, even go back to Timothy. He preached unto the Gentiles. He was then believed on in the world.
Yes.
He was believed on. Do you know that believing doesn't mean agreeing? That doesn't. Those two words are not the same words. Believing means to trust. And when I say I trust in Christ, I believe in Christ, I have faith in Christ. You then have to get the book and look at what it says in the Gospels. And all those red letters, have you followed what he's been saying there? Because real trust, real faith, scripturally, is following what he says there.
Amen.
Not agreeing. I can agree with what people say. It doesn't mean I trust it. It might be right. It doesn't mean I trust it. He was believed upon in the world. He was then, I would have missed one, the six of them. But he then comes back up into glory. He's received back into glory is the end of it. And he has to be received up into glory because the scripture says the Spirit was not given, the promise was not given until he was glorified.
Amen.
He set that example on earth. You know, Christ was that perfect example because his flesh followed his soul, followed his spirit, which his spirit was entangled with the Spirit of God. When you look in the book of John, he talks constantly about the Spirit of God, the one who sent me, the one who gave me authority, the one the one who sent me. And it's that Spirit of God in him that allowed him to talk. He said, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. If you don't know me, you don't know the Father. Because all it was is an earthly vessel speaking, allowing God to speak through him. But he had to be in subject to that Spirit. And when he died, it wasn't just so that Spirit was given. We have this perfect example of what to do and what not to do. When he condemns the Pharisees for not knowing what the, for rebuking him on the Sabbath for healing someone. Another time he says, your sins are forgiven. And they chastise Christ. They come to kill him, it says. And he's preaching in the temple and there's Jews in there saying, why aren't you killing him? And he turns around knowing this and he says, you'll circumcise someone on the Sabbath, but I can't heal. I did one, he says there in John, I did one thing on the Sabbath. I healed a man, and to keep the law of Moses, vainly, you will circumcise someone on the Sabbath. Not understanding what you're doing, but just knowing to follow a rule.
Yeah.
And I heal a man on the Sabbath.
Yeah.
It's like, ponder that. And he said, you still don't understand it. You still don't get it.
Precious Jesus.
And I wonder if we all make mistakes. We all, you know, we all start to try and figure it out ourselves. But it says, lean not unto thy own understanding. Mm. And one of my favorite scriptures is when it says that in our weakness, he is strong.
Amen.
I understand that more now than I will ever understand it. There's so many times that things have happened. And I know I haven't had the right words to say. I know I haven't been strong enough. I know whatever. Mm. But I have leaned upon God and he has intervened through that situation.
Amen.
Not necessarily external, because I've grabbed a hold of his word or I've prayed or whatever, and it's not just a small prayer. You've had to go to God sometimes and get in God's face.
Amen.
Why was Cornelius the first Gentile to receive the gift of the Holy Ghost? Why was his household that first household? Because it says his prayers and his alms became a monument in front of God.
Yes.
Literally, God is looking out to humanity like this, and this monument's in front of him. He can't get past it.
Okay.
Obviously, he's God. He can go around it.
Amen.
But that is in his face. And he says, you know what? I am pointing out. I'm going to use this man. This man right here. So he takes stubborn Peter, who had been with Jesus Christ for 3.5 years, still doesn't fully get it. He even denied Christ 3 times. He weeps bitterly, gets beside himself, comes back. And God still has to get the sledgehammer out and hit him a couple times. Brings down this sheep with all this unclean animal and says it's clean. He goes, no, it's not. It's not clean. Still relying upon his own understanding. Still leaning on that knowledge that he grew up with, that these rabbis had taught. The law of Moses, you know, I'm holding on to it. And God's going, no. This man is clean. And when he realizes and he goes, this is how powerful God had been with him.
Mm-hmm.
He doesn't even finish his sermon. The Spirit of God fell on that hungry household in the middle of him preaching Jesus Christ crucified to them. Jesus Christ crucified was the truth on this earth.
Yes.
It says, Jesus Christ said, I am the light of the world. Mm-hmm. I am the light. God manifested in the flesh is Jesus Christ. And he was that light. And then if you go back to chapter 3, it talks about light being light in the world. And that for everyone who does wicked things, hates the light, mm-hmm. and does not come to light. Because when you're doing things that you shouldn't, when you come to the light, your works are exposed. But whoever does what is true, so whatever had been hidden but now revealed, so whoever follows Christ comes to that light, because you're following that light, so that it may be clearly seen that his works have been carried out in God.
Amen.
So if you are following Christ, it doesn't matter where you are in this world. It does not matter if you're in the darkest, deepest, most nastiest places, spiritually or physically. Christ is the light of the world. Sister Julie, that light of the world then is in us.
Amen.
So even in Matthew, when it says, it almost looks like I'm looking at the camera now. It's kind of weird. We never preach with the camera. So anyway,
but
that's fine. The red button's not on, so you don't record. That light in us, it says, don't hide it under a bushel.
No.
Don't hide it. It's not for that. No. Because you have no idea who you are affecting at that moment.
Mm-hmm.
There's this butterfly effect that's talked about, that if you do one action here, it ripples through the space and time.
Yes.
Yeah? So what happened when my father made that one prayer? Mm-hmm. If you're real God, mm-hmm. prove it to me. That then rippled to see, my father's literally seen thousands upon thousands of people baptized. He's baptized thousands, and he's prayed through thousands to the Holy Ghost. And it was one prayer. One hungry prayer was that. What if one word or two words that you can speak to someone, not in your own mind, but in the spirit that you have, allowing God to speak through you, what if that can change someone's eternal destination?
Yes.
It's not going to happen if you want to say every time. It might just be a little bit of water. It might just be a little sowing here, or a little bit of water there, a little bit of reaping there. But it's not up to us to give the increase, Sister Roberts.
No.
Nothing we can do physically. Pastor Roberts, your wisdom is much, much greater than mine. You have seen things much more than I have. But still, your wisdom and my wisdom, our physical wisdom, hasn't got anything to do with it. It's the Spirit of God that is within us that will affect people. And it's that truth, that which was hidden. Those prophets, I mean, we have so much to be grateful for these men that went on ahead, who only knew God to talk to them. They didn't experience the power of God flowing through their earthly body. And they still were able to hold on to this idea of truth, this consistency. And we now have the full truth on this earth.
Amen.
And you know what's crazy? And Pastor Robert, you even mentioned it today. When we were at the back at these, let's Boko Haram, as they're killing people around the world, and these fundamentalists from different religions, different man-made followings, they're killing people who believe in Christ. And you know what? I want to say a lot of these people might not even have the full understanding of this truth. But they are still giving their lives for something that they so eagerly believe in. And I'll put this on me. And sometimes someone says one thing to me, I'll flip. And I think, oh my goodness, there's people that can keep their mouth shut and let this die, this earthly, fleshly, hey, don't you say that about me. And I'm like, uh-oh.
All right.
That's not Jesus, I promise you that one. Jesus don't speak like that. But I still have the truth. And you know what? God's still there going, hey, come on. Let's keep going. You saw what he did with the disciples.
Yes.
These men turned the world upside down.
Yes.
And you look at what Josephus tries to track these men's ministries. Men going to India, converting hundreds of thousands of people in India, going all the way. They even think that they even made it to the British Isles and preached the gospel here. These men turned the whole world upside down. These men were a bunch of uneducated, for the most part, mistake-making men. John again says that the disciples didn't, all of them didn't believe. It even says Jesus Christ knew who was going to betray him. Do you know what? He still had grace. He still had kindness.
Hallelujah.
I wonder, Pastor Roberts, did he have a choice then to not betray him? Mm-hmm. Would someone else still betray him? But did Judas have a choice then to not do it? I don't think that it was said that it had to be this person. It only says it had to be someone to betray him.
Yes.
It didn't say in the Old Testament it had to be Judas. So he did have a choice.
Mm-hmm.
We all have a choice. Moses said, I say to you this day, choose life or death. Choose light or darkness.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
We know that light.
Yes,
and I'm not trying to preach to you just a good message. I promise you, this is something I've experienced myself. This is why it gets me amped up. I don't like preaching. I don't like being the guy behind the pulpit. I really don't. If it could be me, I'd plan conferences and I'd plan everything else. I'd let my brother do all the preaching, Pastor Roberts. I would. I love listening to my brother. He's a great preacher.
Yes.
But, so you got to get up. You got to proclaim what's been put in you.
Yes.
And if someone's asked me to preach, I'll preach. I'm going to do what I got to do. You got to fill in where you got to fill in. I look at some of these pastors who fill in all the fivefold ministry. They fill in everything. Not completely, because they're not Christ. Christ split himself up into those five offices. But men who have given their lives, they might be the greatest evangelists, but they've had to learn to pastor someone. They've had to learn to teach. They've had to learn to be a prophet. They've had to learn to then go weep beside themselves. Say, oh God, we're falling away. We're straying. God, this enemy's coming up against us. Give me something to say. Not as an evangelist to gather people, but to guide people.
Yes, amen.
We're all called.
Amen.
We are all called.
Yes.
Anyone that can hear the sound of my voice, anyone that walks in front of this church, anyone that is anyone in this world has an opportunity.
Yes.
I don't care how deep they've gone into the occult. I don't care what they've done. I don't care how they've said it, where they've said it.
Mm-hmm.
Till the day of judgment, they have a chance. They have an opportunity to come to know that which is not hidden anymore.
Amen. Amen.
In the end of chapter 6, when Christ talks about being the bread of life, he talks about he gives the history of going back into manna and the Israelites being fed, and he said, your fathers were fed by the bread that came from heaven. But where did that come from? It says it came from God. He said, again, I come from God as well. But then he actually talks about his broader range of disciples, because you know there wasn't just 12 that were following Christ everywhere. There was multitudes.
Yes.
Multitudes of people followed Christ wherever he went.
Right.
Yeah. One time he's actually preaching on the mountain here, and he sneaks off. He has to be alone. He goes up to the mountain by himself. His disciples get in the boat. They go across. Christ walks on the water. Then they get to the other side. Well, all of a sudden, all these ships came to where he was preaching, realized he wasn't there. And you can almost see like a cartoon of them scurrying around the lake to get to Christ. They followed him wherever he went.
Yes.
But when Christ goes on and says that I'm the bread of life, this is why I told you that no one can come to me unless it be granted by the Father. After this, many of his disciples turned back and no longer walked with him. So Jesus said to the 12, do you want to go as well?
That's right.
Do you want to go as well? They walked with truth on earth.
Yes.
And they still turn their backs. So don't think everyone that you, hey, I go to church. I tell you what, if you don't tell people about God with a bit of conviction, and you try and tell them like you're a professor, who actually, if you haven't really studied it, you're not going to sound super knowledgeable. If you don't use your own personal conviction, your own personal testimony, what are they following? Are they following an idea? Or are they following a lifestyle that you are living?
Mm-hmm.
When the scripture talks about being an epistle, a living epistle, a book that you can pick up and read, I can watch each person. We all tell a story.
Mm-hmm.
Are they reading your story, or are you trying to portray a different story?
Mm-hmm.
If you're not talking to someone with a conviction in your own life, how are they going to be convicted?
Yeah.
It's not you that convicts them, it's God. Yeah. But that flow. Truth has to be a flow. You understand that? The Spirit of God has to flow through us.
Amen.
All we are is a conduit that plugs into the main source and allows Him to flow through us. Without that plugging in, without that prayer, without that scripture reading, we become weak. And this isn't that type of weakness where we're made strong. Literally, because we don't know what to do. We're lost. How can you be lost in church? Well, the parable actually says that there'd be wheat and chaff, or tares. There'd be wheat and tares. And you ain't going to know about those tares until you get to the judgment day. That's funny, that isn't it? But you know what's funny? When you actually look at the agricultural side of that, those tares help them the wheat stand up. Did you know that?
Yeah.
If you eat the tares, they're actually more poisonous.
Yeah.
They have an attribute of poison to them. But when you look at what they do, they help prop the wheat up.
Mm-hmm.
The ones who are actually living right. Because the adversity that they can bring, the backbiting, the gossip, the whatever, helps us be stronger.
Amen.
Jesus.
Amen.
What was Christ's biggest problem on earth? What was his biggest problem? And at 8:45 in John it says, "But because I tell the truth, you do not believe me."
Mm-hmm.
It was the unbelief of those that were around him.
Mm-hmm.
Not the disagreements. Different words, different. It was literally, they didn't trust what he was saying.
Mm-hmm.
They didn't trust he was the Christ. They didn't trust that his words came from God, who was in him.
Mm-hmm.
No one else had the Spirit of God in them at that time.
Mm-hmm.
When it came upon them very heavily, in Leviticus, when Aaron's sons give the strange fire and they die, and then Moses turns around to the other sons and says, "Hey, don't grieve, don't go out of the tent." He said, "The anointing of God is upon you. The anointing oil is upon you. You then are holy. So don't go out there. Let the people of Israel grieve for you."
Mm.
Christ's biggest problem is that there was no trust in what he was saying.
Mm.
There was no trust. And I wonder if he still has that problem today when he's not literally walking on the earth as a man.
Mm.
I wonder if our biggest issue in life isn't that with the doctrine that we believe or anything like that. It actually boils down to just trust.
Yes.
Who do we trust? Do we trust this, or do we trust the Spirit of God inside of us?
Mm. Yes.
That's the greatest battle we face on this earth.
Amen.
Is who do we trust?
Mm-hmm.
Because what is truth? That which is not hidden.
Amen.
That which is not hidden. God is true. God is that which is no longer hidden.
Mm.
It even says it in Christ's name.
Mm.
Jesus.
Yes.
God is my Savior. God has become my salvation.
Amen.
Emmanuel.
Amen.
God saves. It was the final revelation of who God was to his people. That no matter where you go, no matter who you are, I will still save you.
Amen.
But there has to be a level of trust.
Yes.
Who do we trust? Do we trust God? The scripture says, can we serve two masters? Do we trust mammon or God? Who do we trust?
Jesus.
This earth, or do we trust God? Do we trust the truth that he has revealed, that is accessible to every single person?
Mm-hmm.
Jesus' name.
Help us, Jesus.
Help us, Lord. Yes, 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 yes. Help us. We do need help. We really do need help sometimes. And it isn't because we're some, I don't know, you could be 50, 40, 30. I'm 30, Nick. Oh my goodness, I'm 30 in October. And I still haven't completely got it. You know, I'm still trying. I'm still trying to learn more about God. And I know men that you think, oh, these are the most anointed, these are the most wisest men I've ever seen. And some of them, or the ones that have said it, who I've thought this about, have said that the older they get, the closer to God they get, the more they realize the little that they know about God. Which is phenomenal, because when you look at eternity, if you get a chance to share eternity with God, and you really get to delve into the depths of God, and he can reveal things to you that he did throughout people's lives, and you can really put the full picture together, then it isn't just a bit of God. It isn't just this bit of inheritance that we have. It's what the Holy Ghost is in us. We get the full truth. We get everything. In Jesus' name. No, Pastor Robert, I don't know if you guys have altar calls. I don't know what you guys do. But if you guys could just pray with me now, we're going to pray that God's hand is upon us, not just in the service, but he's upon those that aren't here. He's upon those that we meet this week. Because there has to be a conviction in us. There has to be a revelation of the truth in us personally before we can ever be a witness in this world. Because otherwise, what are we witnessing of? A witness can only tell what he's seen or what he's heard. So Jesus, Father, we thank you for your presence here.